الحمد لله، نحمده سبحانه ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهدي الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ولا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صل وسلم وبارك عليه وعلى آله وصحابته ومن اتبع سنته بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. أما بعد، we are continuing to revisit and continue to visit the Quran, to explore and to dig out the ayat and the guidance that the Quran is meant to give us, to see what is relevant to our time, what was relevant in the past, and what is pertinent to our future. We cannot plan without having a perspective. The Quran gives us the right perspective. We cannot develop without having information, and the Quran gives us the information. We cannot deal with each other until we understand how and what works and what doesn't. So there's a lot of things that we do not know unless and until we study the Quran. So this is the focus of our series here about the Quran. We are still in Surah Al-Isra, ayah number 11. وَيَدْعُ الْإِنسَانُ بِالشَّرِّ دُعَاءَهُ بِالْخَيْرِ وَكَانَ الْإِنسَانُ عَجُولًا. Man asks in his prayer for evil as if he is asking for something good. Earnest prayer to demolish, to destroy, or earnest prayers asking for things that we do not know whether it's good or bad. Take for example somebody, and I use that example frequently because it's easy to understand, somebody who prays and says, "Oh Allah, please make it easy for me. I want this car." And as soon as he gets a car, he doesn't know that this is the tool for his demise. He doesn't know. There is a story that a man was sitting with Prophet Solomon, alayhi salam, and with them was sitting the angel of death. And the angel of death was smiling. And that man was scared because of the angel of death's look. It's very scary. So he told Suleiman, "Do you know this guy?" He said, "Why are you scared?" He said, "Send me to India. Send me to India." Suleiman, alayhi salam, had the power to use the wind to do anything. So he sent him to India. And he looked at the angel of death and he said, "Why are you smiling?" He said, "Because Allah told me to take the soul of this man in India within a very short period of time. And I was smiling because how would he be in India at the appointed time?" So Allah made him scared of this visitor that he didn't know, and he asked to go to the place where his death is. And that was his last wish, because the angel of death followed and picked his soul and it's gone. So what I'm saying is, there are so many examples for things that we ask for and then later discover it was not good for us. And things that we try to avoid so badly, and then when they happen, we discover they were, after all, the best thing that happens to us. And this is explained explicitly in Surah Al-Baqarah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَعَسَىٰ أَن تَكْرَهُوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ خَيْرٌ لَكُمْ. There may be something that you hate so badly that is good for you. وَعَسَىٰ أَن تُحِبُّوا شَيْئًا وَهُوَ شَرٌ لَكُمْ. In Surah Yunus, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, ولو يعجل الله للناس الشر استعجالهم بالخير لقضي إليهم أجلهم. If Allah were to deliver all the evil prayers that we ask for, not knowing that it was evil, He would have put us to death. Putting us to death here means He would cut short our life, that we don't have a chance to repent, to correct, to modify our ways. This will be the end of it, a prayer. And that's why the Prophet ﷺ tells us, never pray against even your donkey, your mule, your horse, your dog, your camel, because these are tools Allah has given you. If you curse them, Allah says, the Prophet ﷺ says, it may meet an open space in the heaven and your prayer will be answered. So don't pray against your animals. Don't pray against your children. Don't pray against your spouse. Don't pray against anyone. Allah is enough to do what He wills, to achieve His will, not your will. So no matter how bothersome somebody may be to you, how hurtful somebody may be, instead of praying to Allah to hurt them, ask Allah to open their heart. It's a prayer for a prayer. Ask Allah to guide them, or ask Allah at least to protect you from them. That's it. But don't pray for the demolition of somebody's property or life or his demise. Don't do that. So here it says, man, if left to his own devices, would pray for evil as if he were praying for good. And man is created in haste. We are all hasty. We want something, we wanted yesterday. We don't want it even today, we want it yesterday. And this is, by the way, this is a child's attitude. Children do not appreciate time. When you tell a young child, wait for 5 minutes, he doesn't want 5 minutes. So he thinks that wait means I'm not doing it. Okay? And that's why when a child is left by his mom, and the child is young, and she goes to another room, he's crying because he doesn't know when she's coming back. He doesn't know the concept of time. So we adults should appreciate time, should take time, give time, and wait for time to come by. And in the Sunan of Allah, everything in this life has a time of its own. Everything in this life will happen in due time. But the time and the schedule is up to Allah, not up to us. So the word وَكَانَ الْإِنسَانُ عَجُولًا, man is always hasty. He is created in haste. خُلِقَ الْإِنسَانُ مِنْ عَجَلٍ. You see the child coming out of the womb of his mother, crying, frustrated. This is all of us. We have that child still inside us. No matter how old we may be, we have that child that pops up from time to time. We need to put that child under control. That child is our nafs. That child is our nafs. When you want to control your environment, you need to control that child inside you. And there is a great book written by a psychologist, I think his name is Bradshaw, S-H-A-W, and he used to speak over lectures on PBS on human psychology. Very important book called The Child Within Us. The Child Within Us. I hope that you read it. It will open your heart and eyes to a lot of issues related to children, to yourself, to your habits, how to control your habits. It's a very wonderful book. So it moves on, ayah number 12. So this ayah, just this one ayah, it gives us a window to understand when to pray, what to pray, what to ask for, what not to ask for, and to abandon the attitude of hastiness. Don't ask Allah for things for yesterday, and don't ask to hurt anybody. This is what this ayah is telling us. Watch what you ask for. The following ayah, وَجَعَلْنَا اللَّيْلَ وَالنَّهَارَ آيَتَيْنِ, And we have made the day and the night as two signs, two miracles. فَمَحَوْنَا آيَةَ اللَّيْلِ. We have obscured the night miracle, or the miracle of the night, because it's in the dark. You don't see much, you don't recognize much. فَمَحَوْنَا آيَةَ اللَّيْلِ وَجَعَلْنَا آيَةَ النَّهَارِ مُبْصِرَةً. We have made the day sign as a sign of visibility. Everything is clear in front of you. The daylight shows us what we don't see at night. So what are those ayat? This is a lengthy subject. I'm going to make it brief so that we can finish on time, inshallah. Why did Allah make this ayat different? First of all, what are those ayat? We know that the day and the night are not only dark and light. They are also determining the length of night, and the length of day determines how much activity we can do in the daytime, because it's shorter in the winter, longer in the summer, and how much we could do and how much we could sleep at night. In this also, there is an implicit hidden secret that many of us violate because we don't pay attention to. When Allah is the one who decides the length of the day and the length of the night, and the length of the night in the winter is longer, it means that the human body, the human psyche, needs more time to recover through the night in the winter than you need in the summer. That's why in the summer, the Isha and the Fajr may be two-thirds of the night in the winter, between the Isha and the Fajr. Right? So we have to be careful to act accordingly, to organize our life accordingly. Okay? So you don't sleep the whole night in the summer, because if you do, the Fajr may be gone, because in the summer, the night is short. Right? So one has to be careful. So this is one of those ayat. Also, one of the ayat that medicine will tell us about is that through the night, your body rejuvenates millions upon millions of cells, maybe billions. Okay? And that also means we need to use the night appropriately. What is the appropriate use of the night? The Prophet ﷺ prohibited, which means he did not like people staying up at night after Isha unless there is something important, go to bed, especially in the summer, because the night is short. So if you don't sleep immediately after Isha or soon after, then the night will become shorter. You may lose the prayer in the Fajr. So one has to be careful that those ayat are not just something to see, it is something to use, because it carries information behind the day and the night. Okay, why did he make the night time obvious and clear for vision, visible? لِتَبْتَغُوا فَضْلًا مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ. So that you could earn your living and ask Allah to provide for you out of His bounties. وَلِتَعْلَمُوا عَدَدَ السِّنِينَ وَالْحِسَابِ. So the days and the nights added together, they make the week. Weeks added up, they make the month. Months added up, they make the year. So if you want to calculate any length of time, any span of time, it goes back, the primary unit is the day and the night. Likewise, if it determines the months, that also should help us as Muslims to use the day and the night so that we can achieve Allah's purpose in our self-purification. So part of the night is for your sleep and rest, part of the night is for your night prayer or reading Quran or reflection or istighfar, whatever you want to do. The activities are tremendously available for everybody. So Allah here is telling us, لِتَبْتَغُوا فَضْلًا مِنْ رَبِّكُمْ. There is an ayah, and I think it is in Surah Yunus, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about the day and the night together. And he says, Allahumma salli ala Sayyidina Muhammad. Let me try to remember it. So it says to the effect, I will say the translation, that the day and the night are to be used for earning your living and resting at night. Excuse me? No, this is Surah Amma. No, I'm talking about Surah Yunus. It's a different ayah where it does not separate the night from the day, and it makes it possible that you seek your living at night as you seek it in the day. And this is a miracle, because in those days there were no night light or people doing work at night. Even people who were traveling, they would camp and park at night and then start the journey in the morning. So in this ayah, in Surah Yunus, I will try to remember it, it points to the fact that you are given these two elements of the day, which is the daylight time and the night time, so that you can seek to earn your living and seek rest and comfort alternatively. And that points to the fact that indirectly the Quran is pointing to working at night, which is a recent phenomenon after electricity has been coming to us. وَكُلَّ شَيْءٍ فَصَّلْنَاهُ تَفْصِيلًا. This ayah carries that section, that part, everything we have given, everything, or we have managed or explained everything in details. Some people then seek chemistry and physics in the Quran. That's not the details that the Quran is talking about. The Quran points us to the elements, but it does not tell us which element comes where, which element is used for what. It leaves it for you. So why does the Quran say that we have given you everything in details? Because the Quran has given us everything in details. But what is everything? Everything that we could not discover on our own. But anything we could discover on our own is left for us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala open our hearts to the Quran and guide us to follow His guidance. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على عباده الذين اصطفى وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله وصفوته من خلقه وحبيبه. Brothers and sisters, Gaza is still under siege. The Rohingya are still being deported and executed and killed alive. The Uyghur are still in concentration camps. And Yemen is under destruction by the will of the couple of the Gulf states, maybe the rest, I don't know. And we look at those realities and say, what can I do? The minimum is remember these people in your prayer. That's the minimum. So when you make sujood, as you make dua for your children, make dua for their children. As you make dua for your sick ones, make dua for their sick ones. As you make dua for your deceased ones, make dua for these martyrs who die in defense of their deen, in defense of their country and their freedoms. This is a duty. And this is only the bare bone minimum. But there is a lot that we can do that we are not doing. That is to speak for them, to lobby for them, to educate our neighbors about their situations. Those issues are not going to die on their own. They are going to finish. When we do our part, then Allah will send down His support. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala support all of those brothers and sisters everywhere. Allahumma ahdina fi man hadayt, wa afina fi man afayt, wa tawallana fi man tawallayt. وقنا واصرف عنا شر ما قضيت. اللهم اقسم لنا من خشيتك ما تحول به بيننا وبين معصيتك، ومن طاعتك ما تبلغنا به جنتك، ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا. ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقوتنا ما أحييتنا، واجعله الوارث منا، واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا، ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا، ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا، ولا إلى النار مصيرنا. وإذا أردت بقومنا فتنة فنجنا منها يا مولانا غير خزايا ولا مفتونين ولا مبدلين ولا مغيرين. اللهم لا تدع لنا في يومنا هذا ذنبا إلا غفرته، ولا دينا إلا قضيته، ولا مريضا إلا شفيته، ولا مبتلا إلا عافيته، ولا سائلا إلا أعطيته، ولا ميتا إلا رحمته، ولا مجاهدا إلا نصرته، ولا ظالما إلا قصمته. اللهم عليك بالجبارين، اللهم عليك بالمعتدين، اللهم عليك بالظالمين، فإنهم لا يعجزونك. أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله لي ولكم، فستذكرون ما أقول لكم، وأفوض أمري إلى الله، إن الله بصير بالعباد. وأقم الصلاة.